My guest today is guitarist in one of the most exciting bands to come out in a long time, the band Animals as Leaders. They have a new album out called The Joy of Motion. I'd like to welcome Javier Reyes to the show. Javier, thanks for being here.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Hey, so last time we spoke was on the Progressive Nation at Sea Cruise. Did you guys have a good time?
It was actually a lot cooler than I was expecting. I thought it was going to be a little bit closer to NAMM vibe, but it was really cool, man. There was a lot of cool bands that I didn't expect to see.
Actually, that's a good point to bring up is NAMM. You go there every year, I'm sure. How do you enjoy that whole crazy scene?
It's always cool to go check out gear. The more that I go, like, the bigger that it gets, gets pretty hectic. And I mean, at this point, it's like I'm pretty laced with endorsements. So it's like sometimes it's kind of, you know, not necessarily crucial for me to go.
Right.
Because otherwise I start talking to other people and potentially having to leave home company, and that isn't necessarily that was the best idea, even though I just left the hyperness for carbon. Same idea, you know.
So I wanted to ask you about that, changing from Ibanez to Carvin. Why the change, and did you play Carvin guitars on the new album?
Actually, the first album, although I didn't track the first album, most of the first album was actually tracked on a Carvin guitar. I've actually been a fan of Carvin guitars, you know, for a long time. I've always owned Ibanez, but, you know, through friends and just playing Carvins in the past, I've always been a fan. And actually, maybe, you know, 3 years ago, Carvin had actually sent one of their first 8-strings over to us. I remember really liked it well. And then that guitar actually got stolen.
Oh.
We got robbed. So, you know, I was having the eye of or consideration of switching companies or trying a different guitar out, Carvin was definitely something that I always thought was, you know, definitely something up my alley, both aesthetically and just how they sound and how they play. You know, they're awesome guitars. So I reached out to them in the middle of this tour, and, you know, I was just like, hey, you guys, you know, mind sending me some guitars? I want to check some stuff out. And they sent me 2 guitars that I, you know, fell in love with. And I was just like, this is awesome. Getting more out of this guitar, you know, that I have from my Ibanez that are LA custom shop, you know, supposed to be the cream of the crop guitars in the country. And I'm like, carvings that I have owned on these.
Right.
So, you know, I was just like, well, dude, like, and so then, you know, I was talking to the owner and, you know, talking about potential signature and, you know, what we could do as far as design. And, you know, essentially, because, you know, Carvin is pretty much a custom shop, they're able to do a lot more than Ibanez can, you know.
Right.
The drawback with leaving Ibanez is that they're, you know, number 3 largest manufacturer of guitars in the world versus Carvin, who is essentially a custom shop, you know. So what they can do is a lot more unique. They can go outside of their box now, out of their comfort zone, without really interrupting their normal process. Whereas with Ibanez, if I were asked to do something, you know, wood selection or something like fan frets or something up that level, they wouldn't be able to do it, you know.
Interesting. It must make things a lot easier for you when you have guitar made exactly how you like it with the kind of music you guys play.
Yeah, exactly. The more comfortable the guitar is, obviously, the better it is,
right,
you know, to play on it. Considering that, you know, when we travel, the more resilient it is when we put it in airplanes or we put it in a trailer or, you know, going through different climates and whatnot.
So I want to touch on the new album, Joy of Motion, which just came out. Album's amazing. Just some incredible stuff on there. And debuting in the top 25 for an instrumental prog metal band. That must have blown your mind.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. We're pretty excited. I mean, it's pretty cool. Obviously, the numbers look amazing. We're just kind of blown away with, you know, already with what you've achieved and the fact that it still keeps growing, it's mind blowing, you know.
Yeah.
So then the fact that it debuted at number 23 in the Billboards was just like a huge surprise. I mean, apparently it did better than a bunch of other bands that came out around the same time.
You know, there's one thing to be an instrumental band And on top of that, to do what you guys do. So, I mean, congrats on achieving that, because that's not easy. So that's a really great thing. Very, very cool. I mean, and listen, the album kicks ass, so it's no real surprise. If anybody's a fan of it, they can hear the quality. It seemed like there was a lot more of a kind of a live feel on this album. I read somewhere you guys recorded acoustic drums on this one. Is that right?
Correct. Those are real drums. I think there's essentially little to no sampling on that. You know, the bulk of the drums that you hear is all real drums, just properly mixed.
So did you record most of the tracks live together, or was it still sort of, you know, multi-track kind of layered, you know, anyway?
No, it was still very, like, multi-track. You know, similar to the way we've done other albums where, you know, everything was done on the computer first, you know. We demoed the songs first, you know, wrote them on the computer, programmed all the drums. Once that was done, we actually re-recorded all the, you know, guitars to have the final takes, recorded any without pretty much just that. And then once that was done, we went into the studio to do the drums.
Okay.
Once the drums were recorded, we added bass and then solos. And then the last thing that was added was the electronics.
Got it. Okay, great. Were the guitars recorded direct input again or amps?
We did like hybrid of it. We did do the amps, or rather the direct, you know, Axe FX thing that we normally do. Mm-hmm. But what we did in order to capture our live sound was to tone match our Port City amps.
Okay.
With the Axe FX. So it has, you know, the tone match feature that is awesome, you know. So we were using these Port City boutique amps and cabs that we really liked, and we thought were, you know, adding to the sound that we were having. You know, we were using them live, and our sound engineer was just like, man, this is the best you guys have sounded like going through these amps. So we became fans of that tone. So we wanted to capture that as well with using the aspects and using that in the album to help create, you know, a more unique quality to the band. So instead of having to design something from scratch, then the Axe FX was literally just tone matched it and used that for the entire album. And it's actually what we're using now live as well.
Was the bass recorded the same?
The bass is actually, only four songs have real bass. The rest of them have Trillion, which is just a bass software. Yeah, so, I mean, I figured it'd be like a little too hard to, for some of those parts, in order to, you know, play those bass parts, I don't know how we would do it.
Right. When you guys are writing these songs, are you sort of deciding who gets to play what part as it goes, or just whoever came up with that part plays it, or how do you, between you and Tosin, how do you decide who's playing what on each track?
You know, a lot of the songs, you know, particularly the ones that made with Misha, were essentially started off with just Tosin and Misha as far as the arrangement and the composition. You know, when me and Matt came in, it was more so for those particular songs were after the fact. So, you know, adding layers or bodies. You know, at that point, choosing which parts we played, it's just whatever is, you know, kind of feasible live. Obviously, Postman's going to do the lead part, so I'll have to take care of anything that's in between there. But, you know, on the new album, there's actually parts where we go back and forth in Physical Education. I'm playing, you know, the leads while he's playing the rhythm part for the whole song. I think that's the only song we've done that, really. But essentially, I'll always go for the rhythm parts.
Matt brought, I mean, just an amazing element to the live shows, and now how is it finally having him on an album and hearing how that added to the music?
Oh, it's great. I mean, I think you know, when you were talking about having a sense of a live band playing it, I think that's where you're getting that from, you know?
Yeah.
Because of his playing, he's such a very organic player, you know, but put in the context of Animals and Leaders, which is such a rigid and, you know, choreographed setting, you know, it kind of heightens this level of, like, organic, you know, band sort of vibe.
Do you guys, I mean, you guys rehearsing all the time and really putting a lot of focus on the live show. I mean, it seems like that, and they're very intense, very aggressive sort of a live experience. How much do you guys work on that?
Not very much. We rehearsed maybe like a week or 2 weeks.
Really? Before. That's amazing.
Yeah. You know, we have ideas and we'll talk about ideas, and then as far as visual stuff, well, it's just a work in progress. You know, we keep adding a little bit more and more. We have our visuals guy that also, you know, he comes up with ideas as well, or we tell him ideas and kind of, you know, makes them into a reality sort of thing.
Right. Have you gotten used to playing 8-string the majority of the time? Do you miss, you know, playing on a 6-string regular? Or?
Well, I play 6-string when I do my nylon. But I saw when I play electric, yeah, I'm kind of used to doing 8-string now. Whenever I grab a 6, I feel like I don't know how to play.
Do you miss that ever? Do you ever, after the intensity of those shows, just every once in a while say, man, I wish I could just play in an acoustic cover band for an hour just to relax?
Not at all. I don't think I ever want to be in a cover band. I don't necessarily play just for the sake of playing. Like, I like writing. Yeah, I don't know if I could do a cover band.
No, I'm kidding. What are your influences, man? Where do you draw this from? And was this music always what you were into?
I listen to a variety of music, man. You know, it's not always necessarily guitar-centric or, like, you know, prog. It's not necessarily always prog or metal. I listen to a lot of electronic, a lot of, you know, indie, some jazz, some Latin stuff, classical, you know. Just because I like music, I tend to find, you know, pretty melodies throughout all styles of music, and hearing those melodies in different contexts is what allows me to, you know, expand my palette, if you will.
Right.
I'm a guitarist, and you know, I'm for whatever reasons, I ended up in a band that's super shreddy and all this other stuff, and I have to like create, you know, interesting guitar parts. At the same time, you know, I'm trying to also, you know, just write music that's fun to listen to. So combining those two things is kind of, you know, where we're pulling these types of inspirations from. And then, you know, with Closing, as far as his stuff, he's very technique driven. So when he writes his stuff, he's thinking of a technique, and then at the same time, he's also trying to combine, you know, these elements of conventional music that the majority of the population likes, you know, but put into this context of prog and metal that is obviously more niche, right, market, and a niche more of a taste.
Yeah, I mean, you guys and you know, Periphery and some of these other bands that are out there right now seem to be the new sort of kings of guitar, you know, kind of picking up the mantle, I guess. I mean, you guys feel that way when those articles are written about you in Guitar World and all that kind of stuff?
I don't, you know, it's hard to say, yeah, I feel that way. Like, I mean, obviously reading about it is like, okay, I guess we've become these things. you know, people, I just did an interview and someone was like, you consider yourself, you know, a prodigy, and I was just like, no, I don't think so. You know, I can name a few guitar players that I consider better than you, you know, they're better than me, and I could say the same thing for Tosin. You know, I think we're all extremely unique players. But yeah, I mean, I think we're just products of, like, you know, people that you've been influenced and just absorbing it as much as you can. But there's definitely going to be more to come, and who knows what going to happen in 5 years, you know.
Who are some of the top guitar players that influenced you, you know, kind of instrumental wise, you know, like the Vi's and the Satrianis and people like that? Who is in that list that you kind of,
you know, back in the day? I would say like Petrucci, Joe Satriani, Yngwie Malmsteen, Stevie Ray Vaughan. Even though he did a lot of vocals, I think probably my favorite thing he did was the Little Wayne cover.
Right. Yeah, that's amazing. I remember that.
Guitar players like that, Dimebag, you know, he wasn't instrumental, but Jesus Christ, what he was doing back in the day was,
yeah, it was amazing.
I never heard of. So, you know, things along the lines of that. And then I had influences from my, you know, guitar teachers and and then just listening to music outside of metal and then putting that into a context that I thought would be cool.
What's something on your iPod that people would be surprised to know you listen to?
Tigran Hamasyan. Tigran Hamasyan. Hamasyan. He's a piano player that I think from like Iraq or from Armenia that is just phenomenal. I mean, there's some parallels of what they do to what we do, but you know, they're definitely more on the jazz side.
Oh, well, that's cool. There, people should check that out.
Yeah.
Listen, pleasure speaking with you. Congrats on everything, on the band and a new album, and hopefully we'll get to see you on the road.
Right on. Thank you.
All right, man. Take it easy.
Take it easy.
Bye. Thanks, Javier, for the interview. We're going to close with the opening track off Joy of Motion called Cascade. For more information and upcoming interviews, please check theprogreport.com. Thanks.